The golden method of Freudian psychoanalytic practice is interpretation. By means of interpretation, material from the unconscious, such as symbols, images, and dreams, is brought into consciousness so that we can get a better understanding of what takes place in our psyche and our conscious awareness can expand. To the method of interpretation, Jung added amplification. By amplification, we turn actually in the opposite direction. Rather than bring the image into consciousness, we allow ourselves to circumambulate, circle around the symbol and the image. It's an attempt to bring the conscious ego closer to the world of symbols and images that arise from the deeper layers of our psyche, often through dreams. Jung saw amplification as a process of seeking parallels. In the case of a very rare word which you have never come across before, says Jung, you try to find parallel text passages where that word also occurs, and then you try to put the formula you have established from the knowledge of other texts into the new text. If you make the new text a readable whole, you say, now we can read it. That is how we learn to read hieroglyphics and cuneiform inscriptions, and that is how we can read dreams, says Jung. However, amplification means more than seeking cultural and other parallels. In active imagination, the ego reaches out to grasp the archetypal essence and meaning of the drama and the images in the dream. Jung considered his method of active imagination to be a spontaneous amplification in which the person assumes an attitude of passive consciousness open to unconscious influences. Amplification by means of active imagination can take place in a variety of ways, such as writing down dialogues with dream figures or circumambulating the images of a dream. In active imagination, the ego does not bring the symbols of the unconscious into scrutiny in the laboratory of the mind. Rather, the conscious ego ventures into the forest of images brought forth by the psyche, approaches them as much as possible on their territory in order to animate the images, to let them grow, to give them more volume. For example, after a urine analysis, a 50-year-old highly successful male CEO dreamt the following. It is nighttime. I'm milking a cow, but there's no milk coming. I'm then told by an inner voice to bring the cow to the entrance of Jerusalem, to bury it there in a pit and let it cook for several hours or maybe days, and then bring it to Mount Scopus, where we have to run to change the buckets because it gives so much milk. During the coming days, the dreamer amplified the dream by active imagination, going through the events of the dream in a dreamlike state, and this is what he wrote. It is night, very dark. I'm not the one who decides here about this. I'm being led, not leading. Wouldn't imagine myself milking a cow. But okay, that's my task and I accept it. This cow is huge. Much bigger than real cows. She is majestic. I approach hesitantly, but she doesn't move. I start milking, but no milk comes. I don't know what to do, to try harder maybe. I ask her, but she doesn't answer. She just stares back at me, as if reproaching me. Then I hear this voice, I don't know from where. It's a very strong voice, strong but soft. Not loud at all, almost a whisper, yet very clear, penetrating. It's clear to me that this voice knows something that I don't, and I do as I am told. I start walking toward Jerusalem, along an uphill road, pulling the big cow by a rope. It follows silently. I almost feel like I am riding an elephant, though I am pulling the cow behind me. It's simultaneously easy. I feel elevated and heavy and burdensome. We get to the gates of the city, and even though it's night, I can see the people who have gathered there, beggars and thieves, all kinds of outcasts. And here I come with my cow, who looks kind of funny. Don't know if I'm inside or outside the gate, but I'm in that area on a hilly slope where I dig a pit. It feels terrible to bury the cow, but she doesn't really seem to mind. I'm quite horrified, in fact. The big cow lies there, melting in the boiling water, bubbles of water. I sit and wait. I just wait. Very strange mood. It's so quiet. There's no life around. Really, nighttime. I'm all alone. Nothing happens. Very long time. There's nothing I can do. I hardly move as I watch those bubbles in the boiling water as the cow is cooking. It's as if nothing is ever going to happen. Then the sun rises. The cow suddenly climbs out of the pit, and I know I have to take it to Mount Scopus. I'm not really surprised at all that she's well and alive. It seems all natural, all quite natural, I think. There, on top of the mountain, the view of Jerusalem and surroundings is breathtaking. A bird's eye view, seeing it all, but without really being there. Nearby, but not fully in the city. Yet, getting the full map of it. And it's incredible how the milk flows. I don't know who all the people there are. I think it might be all those that I met at the entrance to the city, at the city gate. But it's too much milk. We can't handle it all. Somehow I need to back down, or I have to find a solution. In the absence of personal associations, this dream is predominantly archetypal, as the magical cow that is cooked, brought back to life, and overflows with milk clearly indicates. The cow that accompanies the dreamer all through the dream is undoubtedly the main image to explore by amplification. We go through this process for each image and then look at the bigger picture we have created to find the thread that leads to an understanding or a statement of meaning. The images we could explore by amplification would then be the cow, the absence and then the abundance of milk, the inner voice that speaks to the dreamer, the entrance to Jerusalem, cooking the cow in a pit, Mount Scopus from which the city can be seen, and other images such as the shadow figures described as beggars, thieves, and outcasts. A cow is a domesticated animal associated with milk and nurturing. In archetypal terms, the cow is associated with a great mother. We find her as the cow goddess Isis from Egyptian mythology, and in Ninsun, the wise dream interpreter and queen of the wild cow, as well as in Hindu mythology, where Kamadhenu is the mother goddess of all cows. The sacred red cow can be found as well, both in Jewish and Christian tradition, as well as in Greek mythology. This cow, however, gives no milk. She is not a nurturing cow and is unable to properly support the dreamer. We could say that his cow instinct has dried up. The cow reproaches him because he has ignored her for too long. His relationship with an attitude toward the unconscious, represented by the Great Mother, do not nurture him and need to be re-established. He has lost the ability to extract the warm, sweet milk in life, the joy, nurturing, care, and relationship. Now, however, this outwardly successful man agrees to do the humble work. Compensation from the unconscious comes in the form of a voice, the voice of the self, which guides the dreamer to bring the cow back into its fructifying state and thereby to bring himself into relationship with it. He needs to bring the cow to the entrance of Jerusalem and let it cook in a pit for several hours or days, perhaps. The gates of the city signify an entrance to a center, pregnant with archetypal meaning and symbolic significance. Here, Jerusalem is a city in a dream. It is heavenly Jerusalem, a representation of the self, rather than earthly Jerusalem, which might have emerged through personal associations. The shadow, represented by the beggars and the thieves, stands at the gateway to the self. The big cow now needs to boil in water for hours or days. Although the dreamer feels terrible about this brutality, he needs to remain in a state of being rather than doing, succumbing to forces and processes beyond his ego's control. It is, in fact, the scene of a ritual, quite similar to what we see in fairy tales about animals that must die and be reborn in a new form in order to help the protagonist. This cow represents an instinctual part of the dreamer that has become a huge burden and lost its creative juices, the nurturing milk. It needs to be transformed at the threshold of the city, at the point of transition. The ritual takes place during the night. There is a need to sit in the dark, to patiently remain in a state of depression or in the alchemical negredo, waiting for the sun to rise and the light of consciousness to emerge as the dreamer contemplates the transformation of the cow energy. This is the time of thoughtful introversion, as the cow boils and then emerges transformed as the sun rises. The light of consciousness has awakened the new cow image in the dreamer, and now it has to be taken to Mount Scopus. There, the dreamer is confronted with the problem that the cow provides too much milk. The dream ego does not know what to do with all this libido flowing in such abundance. The dreamer is put to work with a group of shadow figures to collect the milk. He needs to relate both to those shadow figures and to the nurturing cow to keep the flow of the milk in balance. Without the shadow elements, he would be too one-sided. This hard work might be necessary as a way for him to re-engage with the feeling aspect of his life, connect with feminine instinct and the feminine spirit. From Mount Scopus, the dreamer has a bird's eye view of Jerusalem and its environs. He is not in the center, at the heart of the city, but he can see it from above. The stage has moved from the negredo, or sitting in depression, to albedo, or whitening, where there is an influx of conscious awareness, the clear view of the bird flying overhead, seeing the map of the city. The map or the layout of the terrain is clear, but it is overwhelming. Too much view, too high, too much white milk. The next stage in alchemy is the reddening or rubedo, which involves the embodiment of the transformation whereby one makes it one's own. This dreamer is not there yet, but instead is quite overwhelmed by the experience of change. The inner voice, Jerusalem, Mount Scopus, the magical cow, they all point to a spiritual attitude that perhaps needs to be mediated by reality before it can be realized. The image in the dream of more milk than the dreamer can contain points to a very important psychological issue. The floodgates of the psyche have been opened, and the dreamer is inundated with creative energy, more than he can handle. At such times, it is crucial that the ego steps in and objects by taking a stance against the psyche, asking that it curtail the flood, reducing its offering to just enough energy for the person to manage. The dream image of the cow's milk swings from its absence, the lack of psychic energy, to too much. A balance between the extremes needs to be found, and it is the ego's job to find it by taking a strong stance at the doorway between consciousness and the unconscious. The dreamer allowed himself to follow the inner voice and was willing to be changed by the process, but he must then as well find a balance between his ego and his deeper resources. Now, it is our constant task to find a balance and an ongoing dialogue between our conscious ego and the wellspring of resources in the depth of our psyche.